Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson Sorcery. This is the RPG Chick Amethyst Lunatari, sounding probably a lot better from last episode. Voice is still a little scratchy, but the old timbre, or whatever you call it, the pitch is returning. I hate that I always get laryngitis like that. I mean, this happened earlier in my playthrough of this, because I play this once a week, so you've literally seen me, like, well, not through the years, but through the year or something. So we're here in the, well, anyway, like I always briefly explain, this is an interactive Let's Play. At the end of this video, you'll get to choose among the choices presented, and that will be, you know, majority rules vote going forward into the next episode. So we want to cast a spell. I had all of 2 votes, probably because I only had 3 or 4 days in which to vote. Might have grabbed another vote or 2 along the way. But I want to get back to my Monday schedule, so this should be it, because it is now Sunday night as I'm recording this. So anyway, the eastern part of this area, I always forget the name. The names of this game don't resonate with me. Mempeng. Very strange names. Not your typical, like, Faerun-style names. Like Dungeons and Dragons, they, you know, Steve Jackson games were a little, made something a little different with it, which is awesome. But I find it hard to remember names like Kakabad and Analand and Mampang, you know. A lot of A's being used. But anyway, yeah, so the path rounds a tower to the north and splits again. Up ahead is a tower surrounded by thick mud. South of here is another tower, perhaps coated over some kind of black carapace. You reach out and gently touch the black surface of the tower by the wall. It is hard to the touch, smooth and cool. If there was even a doorway here, you cannot make it out. Now this area is like filled with magic. Seemingly volatile in nature, so we should be careful, but as a result of being here, I hope I will, you know, gain enhanced magic abilities, maybe learn some new spells. So, unanimous with the 2 votes we got to cast a spell. For what purpose, I'm not sure. Maybe to crack the black carapace. So we have... whoop. I hate when that happens. I'm trying to get to the D. There. Okay, that sounded wrong. Heal disease. You know, I've been wondering, because there was a black substance over the door and the timbers not far from the door. We touched it and we got some kind of disease. And, which, like, spread out my arm, I think, like, something like that, on my hand or arm. We prayed to Korga, and the, you know, our god Korga, and the disease was, you know, eliminated, but, or cured. So I'm wondering if this, black substance is the same thing. I mean, we did touch it. Nothing happened to us this time. So it's definitely something to think about. Something to think about. See the future, huh? I could do that. Sounds interesting. Cause strength. Unknown. Purr. Conjure a mystic cat. Just guessing. I don't know. Okay, so that's lightning. We can cast lightning at it. We can find safe passage, which is always good. There's several good choices. Well, let's see the future. This, I think, might give us a glimpse into perhaps a successful thing for us to do with this in this location, or we might see a failed action which we will find that we should not try. You sit cross-legged on the ground and put your palms on the orb. You gather the stars into your design around you, and everything changes. This is a room filled with skeletons who crawl over one another in a terrible clacking and knocking of bones. Above them hangs a dark, dripping shape. Dripping like this black stuff. Skeletons crawling over them with a dark shape dripping above them. You look up at the shape and see one enormous ruined eye staring back. Water pools from an oversized tongue sparkling as it falls. The vision fades. Huh. Some kind of beast? Some kind of monster? With an eye. I'm gonna guess something else. Safe passage. You craft the enchantment and a familiar calm voice begins to speak to you. This tower is protected by a spell of strength, the voice tells you. It can be overcome, but the counter is most obscure indeed. Its message delivered, the spell fades. A spell of strength. What do you think could counter strength? It would be one of these spells, wouldn't it? I mean, we already cast two of them. Cure disease? Maybe it's this unknown thing. That's strength. I'm gonna try it. Purr. Nice. That's it. That must be the counter for strength. Reaching up to the constellations above, you create the spell, and before your eyes, the black coating seems to trickle away into the ground. The tower door is revealed. Look inside first. You peer inside the curious tower, but the interior is shadowy and dark. Going in. You slip inside the strange tower. Oh, it's this tower. I thought it was this tower. I mean, look closer to that one, but alright. Yoop. The dim room smells musty, like the interior of an old chest. There is no light. The tiny windows are all covered over with the curious thick black substance that coats the walls and floor. The substance seems to spout in slow globs from an outlet set into a raised block of stone in the middle of the chamber. How about not touch the floor? Look at the stone block. The positioning of the block is like that on an altar, but the pipe drilled through it reminds you of alchemical equipment. The thick sludge coming through does not remind of anything much, however. Seriously? These are the only options we have other than just leaving? Touch the floor, touch the oozing black slime. These both sound like terrible ideas. What was that spell? What's that spell? Purr? Is it even going to be in here? It's Pep. If that counters spell, I mean, what is it? Weakness? Cause weakness? It's not here. Why am I gonna touch this stuff again? Maybe I could cast a spell of cure disease. Or cast a purr stuff. This is against my better judgment. But what else did we come in here to do? You reach out to touch the oozing black slime coming from the altar block. It is curiously warm and quick-moving, covering your fingertips in moments and then seeming to climb as though alive or driven by some strange force up your hand towards your wrist. You snatch your arm away but find you are already quite stuck. Wait. You wait. There seems nothing else you can do. The black goo solidifies, turning ice cold as it does so. It shrinks as it cools, and you feel it tugging one by one at the tiny hairs of your hand and wrists, but then you feel something else, a gathering strength. Tug free? You try to tug free, but the hardened slime is like iron around your wrists this time, but you are definitely growing stronger. Oh. I thought the gathering strength was the slime. I am growing stronger. Close my eyes. You close your eyes, trying to understand what is happening inside you. It is as though... It feels as though the fibers of your body are growing thicker with every moment. Well, this is a good thing, right? So let's wait. My stamina just went up to 21. Oh, it had gone up to 19 before that. I didn't even notice. I only noticed the gap between... Yeah. This is awesome. You wait, unsure of what else you can do. More and more of the goo is flowing over you. You feel your arm muscles growing in size. Waiting. You keep waiting, trying to calm your breathing. Oh, but it's coming in ragged gasps now. Your heart is beginning to pound hard and fast in your chest. Your breath is growing short. Okay, tug free, we're done. You tug... Again, but nothing happens. The goo flows further around you. With your newfound power, you tug on the bond around your wrist, and as you roar with fury, your arm breaks free, shattering the black slime in all directions. You are free and more powerful than ever before. Nice. Now I feel confident to touch the floor for whatever the hell reason we're going to do that. You run your fingers over the slime on the floor. Mere seconds after leaving the pipe, it has congealed into a glassy layer, cool and smooth like caramelized sugar. You step outside once more into the cool of the ruins. You feel three times the woman you were. Once, twice, three times, lady. Okay, never mind. My voice still isn't that good. You follow the path of stepping stones away from the black-coated tower until it joins the main path once more. The wind picks up a little spray from the water and splashes it into your face. It stings where it touches you. Wow, we have max stamina, 23 now. Look into the water. You lean over the path and look down into the water. It is black, reflectionless, as though infinitely deep. Drop a stone into the water. You drop one of your pebbles into the water. It sinks without a trace, and without even a ripple. The air seems to fizz and crackle with secret energy. Which way now? Well, now we will go... this kind of leads back to where we were. I don't know if we can go here from there, but let's just go... I mean, if we can visit all these... this could take a couple episodes. So let's head, east, then. The sun bakes the flagstones. You cross the waters and push your way inside the crumbling tower without knowing what you might find. A fetid scent assaults your nostrils. The inside of the tower is cavernous, far larger than should be possible. The stone floor on which you stand has turned to a thin strip of soft earth choked with reeds, and beyond it is a deep pool of foul-smelling water. Really? So we're in a... tower? A swamp inside a tower. Look across the swamp. insects buzz, and the reeds rustle as creatures pass between them. You cannot spot the ceiling of this room, but there must be one, surely. In the center of the marsh, a platform with a low hut sits, perched on rotten stilts. A boardwalk leads to it, dotted with spent torches. Explore the room. You make your way a little further into the room. The floor is dirt, and the little beach by the door soon disappears into the swamp. There is no way to walk around the room. Go down to the water. You make your way to the water's edge, your boots sinking a little into the mud. The water is opaque, but clearly moving. It slowly spirals toward the hut in the distance. Nearby is a frothy, bubbling section of water. It is large and seems to be getting more agitated as you draw near. Huh. Something in there. You watch the froth bubble and break. Slick with grime. Nothing else changes. Whatever is causing it must be large. Toss a rock in? It's something that's gonna fight us. Yep. Oh my god. You idly... This is actually a colored... This is colored. You idly toss a rock into the froth. Something begins to rumble. The water sloshes over your boots, then something huge bursts out. It towers above you, a lumpy mass of mud and reeds. Massive arms stretch out, and a huge gaping mouth opens. And it has fingers with more mouths on them. It is a slime eater! Do we have to fight it? Can we retreat? You try to dance back. Nope, can't retreat. Seeking the safety of land, but a huge hand lashes out and grabs you. The muddy... Ooh, we lost two stamina already. The muddy paw squeezes, nearly cracking a rib. Kicking and biting, you force the monster to release you. It drops you onto the shore, and you scramble away. Okay, so here it looks the same as we've seen before. This is, The City of Thieves. Episode 2. Not Kakabad. I can't think of a name of it. You barely have time to draw your sword before it attacks again. Defend. Good call. The slime eater growls at you, gobbing filth from its blubbering lips. You drop back through the water and raise your sword, hoping to defend yourself. The creature skulks in the brackish water, then rises up and charges. You brace yourself as its arms come splashing down, pushing your head under the filthy water. Yeah, we'll take this. Good. That was a good one. You risk an attack. Standing firm, you swing a mighty blow at the slime eater, catching it as it roars about to attack. You plunge your sword deep into its blubbery hide. Its flesh begins to boil strangely. Then it drops under the water, almost out of sight. Now, I don't remember. It's been a while since I fought this thing. When it goes under the water, that might be when it's about to attack. I'm not completely sure. Or maybe that's when it's harder to hit. So let's do a sideswipe. Yeah, it doesn't attack. Looks like it might be the second thing I thought of. Dropping your weight, you chop a heavy stroke against the slime eater. Low in the water, the monster escapes mostly unharmed. It grunts as it slinks back. It sinks lower into the water, its eyes on you. Sideswipe again. Oh, I think I cut it, actually. Good, though, I got it for two. Back against the tree, you deliver a strong swing at the slime eater, catching it a light blow. Its mouth is thick with blood. Figured it'd just be made out of slime. Sideswipe it. Ah, nope, got me. Ouch. The slime eater reaches out with long, clawed hands. You almost fumble your sword into the dark water. That would have been sudden death. Oh man, it just barely got me there too. The slime eater sidles to the water, knocking you over. You defend yourself as best you can. Blood trickles over the hilt of your sword, making it slippery. The smell is getting worse. Sidestepping, you slash out at the slime eater, slipping a light blow past its clawed hands. The slime eater lifts up from the water, then crashes back down, bits of its body bubbling and boiling. It drops down into the mud, watching you intently. Good, I like I'm getting a two every time. Feinting left, you slice at the slime eater, catching it a passing cut. The slime eater lumbers backwards through the pool, screaming and howling in a bubbling voice. It begins to lift its bulk out of the water, sending ripples across the marsh. Nope, I should have anticipated that. The The slime eater spits a fountain of foul goop at you out. Okay, that was awkward sentence. You defend yourself as best as you can. Blood drips over the hilt of your sword, making it slippery. It slides lower into the slime, sending up bubbles of foul water. Gotcha. I'm gonna do that over there. I know. Shame. 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 7 stamina loss. Quick as a flash, you slash at the slime eater. The slime eater roars up, exposing a soft area beneath its jaw. You strike with your sword and it sinks in deep. Green ooze leaks down your neck. And then, silence. And then we try again. Because that was shameful. Defending. Cutting. Oh, man. Ah. I'm probably doing this one over too. Standing firm, you swing a mighty blow at the slime eater, catching it a light blow. Yeah, we're doing this one. Fainting left, you slice at the slime eater, landing a light jab below its thick arms. The water around the monster begins to move. That defend. You can almost smell the creature growing enraged and duck quickly backwards through the mud. You are not a moment too soon. Emitting a foul gobbet of filth from beneath its blubbery lips, the slime eater thumps forward, hoping to pull you apart. It reaches long, clawed arms out of the thick water. Same. 7 stamina lost. Technically, I think it was a quicker battle. Maybe? I don't know. I wasn't reading everything. That's probably why it feels that way to me. Defend. Okay. Sideswipe it. Low in the water, the monster escapes mostly unharmed. It disappears into the marsh, almost invisible. Sinks lower into the water, its eyes on you. Low cut. Oh, it just barely did anything. Okay, now we defend. Good. That was actually more than I wanted to hit it for. Now it begins to move, defend. Creature's head is lifting up. Defend. Cut. Got him. Back against the tree, you deliver a strong swing at the slime eater, but you cannot cut through the water with enough power to do the creature much harm. One more. Nice. 4 stamina lost. Decent dueling. Green ooze leaks down your neck. Yummy. It's my favorite. Green ooze. The slime eater's corpse slips underneath the waves of the battle. The fireflies, disturbed by the battle, soon settle back into their routines. In a distance, the hut still sits on its platform. Look into the water. You peer into the murky water. There was no sign of any more beasts, but then there was no sign of the last one, either. let's see. Maybe we'll hover across the water if we have the option. Okay, I'm gonna throw explosive pebbles. I could do that, I really, really haven't used them. I think I did once. Mud, well that's a good spell for the marshland. I don't have the ingredient though. Create a force field. Interesting idea. Yeah, lightning bolt. Safe passage, this is what I was thinking of. Create a stench. Control non-intelligent creatures. Well, not only does it take 3 stamina, but I don't know if there's any under there. I haven't seen that one pop up very often. Sense danger. 1 stamina. Let's do this one. You spin the constellations into shape around you and feel a terrible sense of foreboding emanating from the water. Something is wrong. Okay. Moving back from the water. You make your way back towards the door. Step onto the boardwalk. Can I get to the hut from the boardwalk? You step onto the boards, which creak under your weight, causing the torches to sway gently. You see no movement in the hut. The wood creaks under your feet. Look at the water. Standing on the boardwalk, still a little distance from the hut, you notice the swamp is moving. The muddy water is spiraling slowly. The boardwalk creaches and lurches to the side. You manage to keep your balance, and it stills, though it is now slanted. Watch the ripples. You examine the ripples around the stilts. They come at random, often moving in conflicting directions. Could it be creatures moving, or something else? The boardwalk is sagging dangerously now. Maybe I should just go? You cannot stay here for long. It is not safe. Walk to the hut. You begin to walk towards the hut, and you hear a snap. The boardwalk begins to tilt sideways, and you scramble to keep your footing. It is about to collapse. Run! You race toward the hut, stumbling across cracking planks. The wood crumbles beneath you just as you reach the safety of the platform. Whew. Hopefully we can levitate or float across, hover in the air across, whatever they want to call it. You are safe for now inside the hut. There is very little here. A row of tables with some rotten chairs tucked in beneath. On one of the tables, a stack of damp parchment is slowly turning into fur. What? Turning into fur? On one side of the hut is a ragged hole in the floor. Hmm. Parchments. Turning into fur. The parchments appear to be the scrawled logs of whoever was stationed here. The opening remarks are simple. The spell has taken root. The reaction is self-sustaining and appears to be maintaining scale. Okay, reading on. Day 2. The spell has been self-perpetuating for 30 hours and appears to be entirely stable. Success! I wonder what kind of spell, what kind of reaction? Is it to turn, have things grow fur? Day 4. The boardwalk is definitely sagging. I do not believe it can take my weight anymore. Day 6. The force fields appear to work. For brief periods of time, they are countering successfully, but they are tiring to cast. Which day is it? The last of my supplies are exhausted. The whirlpool is exhibiting strange behavior. Whatever lies beneath seems to have reached capacity, or is pushing back. Something has climbed up from the whirlpool. I can feel it moving underneath the hut. Tell Rosa I miss her. Tell Valaquesh she can go to Hell's Mouth without a fur coat. That is the last entry. Ugh. Rosa. And Valaquesh? Is he trying to make a fur coat for her? Out of the parchment he was working on. Search the drawers. You quickly rifle the drawers and tables, but it seems whoever cleared out left nothing behind except the notes of their work. Or they were killed? Look at the hole. Being careful not to go too close, you lean over the hole in the floorboards and look down to the mud pool. You cannot help but notice the scratch marks of claws in the planks near the hole. The boardwalk is gone, and you cannot stay here, but you have no choice to drop down into the water and swim. Yes, I have a choice. I have the Zen. Isn't it Zen? The Zen spell? Seriously? Well, these two towers are connected. So we're swimming, though. We're not taking this way. Oh, I wish I could float up. I don't want to be in there with whatever that is. Of course, oh, my rations! Seriously? Of course, all your water damageable possessions have been ruined. Oh man, I should have eaten my food. I didn't. Oh. Thankfully, however, the pages of your spellbook are protected. But all of your soft food has been ruined. Still, your fleas have been washed away. Fleas? Since when do I have fleas? You're trying to swim, but the swamp is more mud than water, and is definitely a whirlpool, sucking you downwards slowly but inescapably. Watch, now I can cast a spell to levitate. Nope. I still have the medallion. Exploding pebbles. I'm not sure how that can help me. Control mind creatures, mindless creatures. Maybe fish can help me. Lift me up and just create a stench. I don't have that. I don't have quicksand. That would harm me, I'm thinking, not help me. Safe passage. You cast a spell. A quiet voice enters your mind. The only hope of escape is to escape the magic of this room, cries the voice in alarm, and quickly, the swirling water pulls at your feet. To escape the magic of this room. Cast a counterspell? Let's see if I have that. Counterspell for what? Faf? If Faf is available. I want to cast Zen, damn it. So, if this is like a quicksand type thing going on, Faf. Looking to the stars, you craft the magic, but the force field does not materialize. Instead, the whirlpool begins to slow, and then it stills. The water also begins to clear. Why would the swamp be affected by such a spell? Because I just countered it, I think. But you begin to tread water easily. You swim with strong strokes. The water is still quite disgusting, and small creatures flicker on either side of you. You will carry this smell on you for some time. Great, so we just got rid of fleas. And, now we smell bad. You swim back to the shore, shaking off the water as best you can. Okay. So, I'm not going to leave this up to a choice, because it's really just who knows which one is which to even make some kind of intelligent choice. You take a moment to regain your breath. Thick, foul water streams from your cloak. The water is deathly still. Move up from the water. You make your way up towards the door. Leave by the near door. You turn away from the swamp. Its foul gas is making you gag and choke. There are other doors from this place, but only one that you can reach. Yes, because we swam that way. All right, another tower. Thin heat beats down from an empty sky. You enter the next tower nervously, but you freeze on the threshold. In place of a door, this tower contains nothing but a yawning pit clustered with thin needle-like spikes. A narrow stone walkway heads away from the door and leads out a short way over the pit, but it does not go as far as the door on the far side. A yawning pit with thin needle-like spikes. So we need to find our own way over the pit. We'll go back the way we came. On a whim, you look up and notice that the ceiling is fairly high and sports several misshapen rock protrusions. Look at the spikes. If there was a safe way down into the pit, one might be able to slip between the spikes, but the sides of the pit are also spiked, and to jump in would be quite suicidal. There is no ledge around the edge of the pit either. You step onto the stone platform and feel curiously lighter. Check my pack. I need... Oh, God. My rations, damn it. And we can't rewind. You check your pack, but all your possessions are as you left them. Instead, you realize your feet are no longer touching the ground. You are floating. Yeah, let myself fly. We can, maybe push ourselves off from something, or actually we can make ourselves head towards the other door on the other side. You fly happily upwards to the ceiling. Oh, hello. Huh. Eventually you hit the ceiling and gently bounce off. Well, since we're here, right, we're still near the ceiling? Examine it. Turning to look upwards, you see that the ceiling is studded with curiously shaped rocks sticking out at random angles. Most are smooth and all are small enough to grip. They have been deliberately placed. Gripping the rocks will allow you to navigate the room. The floor is a long way down, and the spikes gleaming in the sunlight from the open door. The spikes are so thin you cannot even see the ones directly below you. Explore the ceiling. With some effort, you pull yourself along the roof. The room is fairly uniform, broken only by the inverted landscape of rocks. Towards the center of the room, you spy a small depression in the ceiling. Let's head there. You guide yourself towards the depression in the center of the room. Pulling along by the rocks is difficult, and you occasionally float off course. Below you, the spikes wait, but thankfully they are well out of reach. Arriving at the center, you see that there has been a small circle cut into the ceiling, and inside, someone has carved a sigil into the stone. Oh, look at that. You swing over to look into the depression at the sigil, but you cannot stay still long enough to see it properly. You bob past the opening and away a short distance across the ceiling. Let's try again. You attempt to look at the sigil again, but unless you can find a way to stay still up here, you are not going to be able to see it properly. The depression is too shadowy for a quick glimpse. How do I make myself stay still? Well, that sense danger. We know the danger's from the spikes. Doubt it'd be from the sigil. Turn to stone. I'm wondering if this is another counterspell situation. Because it's been like that. Float in air. We're already floating in air. Find safe passage. You know, this would be it. Cause fixedness. but I don't have a staff of oak sapling. See the future. That might give us a hint. You wobble into a stationary position and pull out the orb of crystal, casting your spell across it. You see yourself standing before a great door. The air is thick with power. On the door, the sigil 2 is displayed. Then the vision fades. Well, here we're... Would that be the same sigil? Sigil, the, like the Roman numeral 2. Quick, to the spellbook. If anything counters... Sap? Well, gum. Yeah, we don't have a vial of glue. Maybe zap. Counters mud. This counters Zen, which is the floating thing, the floating spell, which it seems we're currently under the effects of. But I don't want to fall down to the spikes. Let's see if zap is even an option first. No. Alright, let's... I don't know. Try this. You move the starlight into order around you, to little effect. You bob upwards slightly, nearly knocking your head on the ceiling. You know what it is? I think we need that. I'm gonna end up killing myself by casting these spells. Hope we find food somewhere. I'm gonna end up, yeah. I think we need that other... We need that caused fixedness. We need that fix one. But I don't have the, I don't have the material I need to do that, so let's float to the door. You crawl across the ceiling towards the far door, descending slowly as you near the walls once more. So that might be... it might be the Roman numeral 2. You step back onto the path and follow it a short way. The sun is beginning to lower and the air begins to cool. Every path seems weighed down with sadness and oppression. It is not a place to stand still. Well, then let's go places. You approach the next weird tower, wondering what you will find this time. Two steps in, you stop and stare. The room is filled with giants. Filled with giants. The giants are milling around the space without clear purpose. They are clearly enchanted creatures. You notice something else. Something large and white is hanging from the ceiling above you. A white bat. Look up. You look up. The white thing near the ceiling looks back through two enormous eye sockets. It is a gigantic humanoid skull. Something drops down from it and hits the floor. It appears to be an oversized tooth. A moment later, the tooth begins to fizz. A cloud of smoke wells up, and from it steps a giant. The room, despite its height, is starting to feel quite crowded. One of the giants wallops another, knocking his teeth out. A moment later, the injured giant vanishes into smoke. The first giant scoops up the loose teeth and drops them into the skull that hangs from the ceiling. Another tooth tumbles from the skull in the ceiling. You snatch the tooth from the ground. It is hot to the touch but cools rapidly in your palm. So now we have more giant teeth. I think we had one. Oh, we have five giant's teeth. I'm gonna have to take these blimberry juice just in case. I hate to do it. Gone. So I'm gonna buy some more food whenever we can. Maybe we should just leave here and come back. Buy food and eat it. Sleep, come back, maybe. What kind of spell are we gonna cast? Are we gonna cast more giants? Summon darkness. Interesting idea. Right, there's no other F thing. Unknown. Interesting. Hover in the air. Hover above the giants. That seems like an interesting idea too. Read minds. Yeah, these are all good choices. Make myself big. I really don't want to fight them. Summon a giant. I think we have enough. What's that? Okay. Was there another Y thing? No. Read minds. You weave the enchantment, pulling on the cloth skull cap as you do so. Your mind is assaulted by giant thoughts, as slow as rock, as dull as rock, a mixture of confusion and a dim-witted confidence that results from their size. Well, they don't seem to be attacking me, at least not yet. I don't know what they're doing there. They're waiting for something? They're stuck in the tower? Not sure. That's darkness. Oops. Giant size. That's summon a giant. Which is the one that, is, you can find out what this is. Zob. You try to bind the enchantment, but you're missing an item that it needs, and so the spell dissipates around you. Another tooth tumbles from the skull in the ceiling. You snatch for the tooth, but you are not fast enough. Moments later, another giant steps forward. The room, despite its height, is starting to feel quite crowded. One giant knocks his own teeth out and puts them into the skull in the ceiling before disappearing. Huh! They're taking their teeth and putting them into the skull. What else can I cast? So whatever the Zob is, we need an ingredient. And we do not have it. I'm trying to figure out the mystery of this room. Oh, that's wrong. Come on, damn you. Why am I... There. Darkness? Oh. Let me see if there's any kind of counter for summon giant? Or big? You know, I have so many. What if I cast my own giant? What would that giant do? So let's try it. It's Yob, I think. You pull a giant's tooth from your pack and throw it on the ground, casting your spell across it. The tooth erupts into a column of smoke from which a towering giant steps out. A moment later, you cannot tell which of the giants is yours. Alright, let's levitate. You spread your arms to cast a spell, but the floor is so crowded with giants' feet, there simply isn't enough room. Another giant disappears, leaving only his teeth behind. Another tooth tumbles from the skull in the ceiling. You snatch this tooth as well. You cannot keep doing this, however. Alright, so wait. A giant disappeared. So maybe there's enough room now to cast this? Try it. Giants are pretty big, so maybe the giant was near me and now I have room? Okay. Consulting the constellations overhead, you bind the spell and the medallion begins to glow as you rise gently up into the air. Yeah, float over to the skull. You float over to the skull. It is a giant's head. However, the lower jaw cavity stuffed full of giant's teeth. Grab a handful. You grab a handful of giant's teeth and float away just as one of the giants comes to swat you from the air. Your weight returns and you settle gradually back down to the ground. Another tooth tumbles from the skull in the ceiling. I grabbed a handful of those things. I have 11 giant's teeth and a goblin's tooth. Okay. I say run for it. You're in no doubt as to what is about to happen. Time to run before more giants appear. The giants in the room can barely move around each other. You might be able to slip between their feet. Run for the far door. You slip past a gigantic pair of ankles, vault an oversized boot, and are out the opposite door before anything can pulverize you. Alright, good. Still waiting for some giant... not giant, but some good... I just have giants on the brain now. For some good choice here that's not just an arbitrary go this path, go that path. You return to the path and walk a short distance. The sun begins to dip, heading toward the horizon. You pause, enjoying the open air outside the tower, and take a moment to count your collection of giant teeth. You now have 11. Yes, I'm aware of that. What path will you take now? Alright, so we've been to many of these. We've been here. Here. Here and here. Whoops. Now we will go here, North Tower. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. It will be night soon. You follow the path and make your way into the next tower uncertainly. What is this place? Why was it built? The tower has a dirt floor into which various lines have been scratched. A chest sits in the middle, a rather obvious bait for whatever trap this room represents. Okay, a chest. Okay, enter. You step a little further into the room. Apart from the chest, the tower is quite empty, identical to any other of the rooms in the other towers, save for its dirt-covered floor. Several zigzagging trails have been left in the dirt. Looking. You look over at the chest. It seems quite unprotected, surrounded by empty, unguarded space. Prod at the ground. You use the walking cane to prod at the ground just in front of you. It immediately and violently explodes as you leap away from the shower of fire and dirt. Is this a minefield? Huh. I wonder if those exploding pebbles are underneath the dirt. Toss something. You take a small stone from your pack and toss it towards the chest. There's another explosion when it lands, a sharp crack that hurls some soil into the air. There does not seem to be any pattern to the mines. You prod directly ahead to no effect. You prod a short distance to the left and the ground explodes once more. Just take a step forward or cast something. Sob, unknown. Keep that in mind. Cause depression. Huh? In what? Create light. Sense danger. Invisible wall. What do we have last down to be using on this stuff? Cause sleepiness. Cannot do, and what's there to be sleepy? Cause speed. Cannot do that. Really sent us spinning, though. Summon a goblin. And send it around to to scout ahead? I don't know, that seems kind of mean. That seems rather mean, even though goblins are not nice creatures. That's the force field. Cause strength. These are my exploding pebbles. That's a good idea. Float? Lightning? Zob is the thing that we don't know. Sob. Nice. As you complete the smell, there's a popping and hissing from your pack. You pull it open to see that one of your snatticat teeth is glowing. A moment later, it has shot up into the air and exploded. A long clawed snatticat leaps down onto the ground. The sob spell has been added to your spellbook. A moment later, the room is a mass of explosions and dirt as the creature leaps and darts this way and that, setting off and avoiding mines to the left and right. Finally, one explodes directly beneath it. The cat flies into the air, flashing into visibility briefly and yowling before it disappears. I feel sad for that. So I killed the poor snatticat. So where would that be added? Here it is. Sob. Create requires a snatticat's tooth. I guess I use my one snatticat tooth. Casting this spell requires a tooth of a snatticat, and when cast, will summon a new snatticat whom the caster may control. Oh well. Take a step forward. You take a step forward. Nothing happens. You prod at the ground in front of you and it explodes violently. You prod to the ground to the left of you and it also explodes. You prod at the ground to the right of you and it explodes as well. You step back to the relative safety of the doorway. You scrutinize the trails in the dirt. One is well-worn, the dirt smooth from many trips back and forth across the minefield. There is another which passes right by the chest. It is much more hastily made as if someone had run through the dirt. What spells do we have available? I think this is going to be my choice, though. Do we have the same things available? Okay, those are the violent, the things. The exploding pebbles. Force field, I'm not going to use. Too much stamina. Ditto. create wind. Oh. You bind the stars into a pattern around you, placing your gale horn to your lips and playing a clear tone. Then you open your arms and allow the wind to snatch you up, blowing you across the minefield and depositing you safely on the other side. Seriously? I was gonna leave this for a choice. I thought the wind might just blow the dirt. It blew me. Alright. You make your way across a stone walkway, arching high into the air above the swirling waters that pool below, until you reach the next curious tower. As you open the door and step through, someone else enters from the other side. She closes the door just as you do. A mirror image of myself? You peer at the creature opposite. Seeing her face is difficult somehow. Your eyes seem to slide off her features. The stranger is peering back at you, but not approaching. You look around the room. It is a wide ring with chairs. There are scuffs on the floor, two semicircles near the center of the room. A large pane of glass stands in the center of the room, sitting in an elaborately carved frame. The stranger stands watching you. It's obviously a mirror, not glass. You raise a hand, and the stranger does so in return. Hello, you say. Goodbye, she replies. Who are you? You ask. Where am I? The stranger responds. Even to speaking to her, you cannot seem to look directly in her face. This is Mampang. Nothing is outside. Where are you from? What am I going? She asks. Do you live here? I live nowhere, they say. You sigh, and the stranger grins. As you are talking, the two of you have edged closer together. You now stand on either side of the glass in the middle of the room. It is a mirror. Duh. The stranger approaches and pauses on the other side of the mirror. What spells? Doesn't seem to be as many. Cause clumsiness? Not gonna do that with three stamina. So we have a lot of choices here. This is the Snatter Cat, which you do not have because you used her only tooth. At least we found out what that spell does. Create light. Clone the caster. Clone the caster. Interesting, because that's what apparently is already going on. That's the light. Just making sure I don't miss any. I, O, and U. Okay, clone the caster. Summon replica creature we do not have. Force field. Not using that because it's three stamina. Cause stupidity. Summon a goblin. Why? Why, man? Why would I do that? This is the clumsiness, I think? I always forget which ones I've looked at. Yeah, I don't want to even try that. That's three stamina. I mean, it might have an effect, but... yeah, not... replica creature. Yeah, can't do. Okay. So which one is this? The... alright. So, choices are the following. Strike the glass. Cast a spell, which is going to be clone a caster. Okay. Or run for the far door. So that's going to be... I'm not casting any other spells. I don't think they'll be useful. And many of them... take 3 stamina, and I have no way to replenish my stamina at this time unless I return to the city. I'm kind of afraid if I leave this place, I won't be able to come back. That's the thing. I want to explore as much of it as I can. So, Leia, cast your votes, leave your comments below. Thanks so much for watching. This is a long episode. But, I couldn't find any suitable choices until now. So, strike the glass, cast a spell, which will be mandatorily clone the caster, or run for the far door. Let me know what you guys think. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks for voting. And always endure. Or, no. Oh god, it's been so long since I even used the phrase. Endure. In enduring, grow strong. See you next week.